What do we expect from a soundtrack these days? A soundtrack's job is typically to accompany and enhance the action on screen, but also to create a potentially unique musical world for the film. Some composers like to write for full orchestra, others like to write for smaller groups of instruments, and some prefer to lean into sound design. But what if you need to create folk music for a country that doesn't exist? Well, if you're the French composer Alexandre Desplat, then maybe you'll reach for a Russian folk orchestra, two yodelers, and an alp horn player. Alexandre Desplat has become one of the big names in film composing. He's written major films, including the final Harry Potter films, The King's Speech, and The Twilight Saga. But he's also created less conventional, more unusual scores for films such as The Curious Case of Benjamin Britten or The Imitation Game. He's also often collaborated with the equally unconventional and unique director, Wes Anderson. The two have worked together on five films, including The Grand Budapest Hotel. This film is set in the fictional country of Zbrojska, on the easternmost border of the European continent, below the Alpine Sudeten Forest, in a time between World War I and World War II, which never really existed. This now somewhat run-down, spacious Grand Hotel still echoes the splendor of the Habsburg era, and so the composer is supposed to reflect this location and time in his music. But Desplat is faced with a big problem. How can he compose music for a country that never really existed? In the following minutes, we're going to look at how Desplat masters this task magnificently. By the way, if you're interested in dramatically improving your sight reading, writing, and ear training skills, then I'm hosting a live free workshop on that soon. There's more details at the end of this video or in the description. As Desplat has said, very early on when I read the script, Wes mentioned some kind of a sound world that would emerge from Mitteleuropa, what our imagination could hear from these Mitteleuropa mid-century sounds. And Mitteleuropa, for that film, goes from Switzerland all the way to Turkey. It's a wide band of land in which there are instruments and rhythms and melodies that you can quickly identify. Of course, you can think of the zither, the balalaikas, the percussion instruments that come from the east, the alpenhorns. Desplat said this in an interview about his music for the film. Mitteleuropa, as Desplat describes it, does not have just one culture. Mitteleuropa is a multi-layered area with many different people, ways of life, and also traditions and musical styles. Life in Switzerland is very different from life in Turkey, for example. So Desplat is now faced with the difficult task of somehow reconciling all these influences. And so he starts with the Swiss influences. The film opens with two yodelers singing Sorote Zaueli. I'm sorry if I pronounced that wrong. But this is a Swiss folk song as the story opens. And soon we hear the main theme presented to us by a cymbalom. What's a cymbalom, you may be wondering? A cymbalom is a stringed instrument that is struck with clappers, and it's particularly popular in Hungary. But this type of instrument is also pretty popular in the Alpine region, which is after all where we're supposed to be in the story. In addition, there are balalaikas and some lovely mandolins. This main theme is beautiful, but it's also wistful and nostalgic. It sounds as purple as Mr. Mustafa's suit, which he wears in his first appearance in the film. Mr. Gustav H's theme also sounds somewhat wistful. Many themes sound as if they were very familiar Russian folk melodies. Desplat was often inspired by traditional Russian music, and perhaps the wintry scenes in this movie might make us think of the Eastern European winters. The wintry yet warm character of the film comes through very strongly throughout the soundtrack. For example, in this scene at the Gabelmeister's Peak, at the monastery high up on the mountain, there are tubular bells, sleigh bells, and a glockenspiel conveying this magical frosty character. These instruments might make us think of the Russian composer Tchaikovsky. Think of the glassy, shimmering percussion instruments in The Nutcracker, for example. But this is also contrasted by an electric organ, a virtuoso cymbalom solo, and a male chorus. So Desplat does not only write idiomatic music with elements of folk, he also adds his own touch and taste, creating something separate and distinct from the folk music elements he's borrowing. All this usage of folk instruments does not mean, however, that Desplat completely dispenses with the traditional orchestra. For dramatic scenes or deliberately exaggerated scenes, Desplat also likes to use a few brass instruments, like threatening trombones or heroic horns, which are also often supported by marching percussion. This tends to symbolize the martial emergence and the threatening approach of the fascist groups, which are very exaggerated and ridiculously portrayed in the films. The somewhat clumsy Lutz Police are musically represented by a triangle, a Hammond organ, timpani, a bass balalaika, and an almost jazzy snare drum accompaniment. Or take this track. The troop theme already has a more menacing sound here. Trombones, horns, bass clarinets, marching drums, and a full church organ are added. There's a harp, a glockenspiel, a xylophone, and for whatever reason, a recorder ensemble, which adds a comic effect. This menacing character runs throughout the whole film. They're often dark and gloomy, but mostly overdrawn and exaggerated. Everything seems to live in Wes Anderson's cinematic snow globe. Desplat makes us feel nostalgia for something that never existed. He uses this wide array of folk instruments, scales, and dance rhythms, mixed together with Desplat's own artistic taste and sensibilities, to create this folk culture which feels so real, at least real within the boundaries of Wes Anderson's pink, sugary snow globe. And he does this so well that he actually won the Oscar for Best Original Score.
The Oscar goes to Alexandre Desplat, the Grand Budapest Hotel.
Sometimes it doesn't have to be the big epic orchestra painting a huge symphonic canvas with radiant colors. Sometimes it can just be 50 balalaika players, a cymbalom, and some yodelers. How's your sight reading, your musical writing skills, your ear training? If you want to seriously improve your musicianship, then you need excellent foundations. And I believe you can learn these foundations in 1 week. I'm hosting a live workshop where you will learn the essential foundations for sight reading and for quality ear training. These are skills which will transform your musicianship and open up massive doors into your musical future. And this workshop is all for free, and I'll be offering discounts on my premium programs too for those who sign up. So if you want to join this live free workshop that I am hosting, then you can visit the link in the description below. Great musicians need real training. So visit the link in the description for this free live workshop, which is happening at the end of August.
I will. Merci. Merci beaucoup.